Take 75.
112. When you're down in trouble and you need some loving care, and nothing is going right, close your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there, yes I will. You got a friend. The sky above you grows dark and full of clouds, and that old north wind begins to blow. Keep your head together and call my name out loud, and soon you'll hear me knocking at your. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running, yeah, to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there, yes I will, to see you again. Now ain't it good to know that you got a friend? When people can be so cold, they'll hurt you, yes, desert you, and take your soul if you let them, oh, let them. You just call out my name, and you know. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there, yes I will. You got a friend, you got a friend, you got a friend, you got a friend.
That's a wrap.
Nailed it.
I like that ending.
All right, that was fun. That was fun playing that song.
Good times, yeah.
Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Yes, happy Thanksgiving. Thank you to all Native Americans who have supplied everything for us.
So, episode one of the Morewood Chronicles.
Yes, it's exciting. Had a good time. Listening to the whole album, you know, I knew a lot of it. I told you in the intro, I knew a lot of
right,
it.
Right, right.
You had mentioned that you didn't think you really knew a lot. But my question now to you is, did you know more than you thought you knew?
Way more than I thought I knew. But that being said, I've never listened to an album this way pretty much ever. Like, I completely immersed myself in the album for about a week.
Right, with the intention of really listening to it.
Right, exactly.
Right, I gotcha.
For those of you who are just joining us, what we're doing is counting down Billboard's top 10 number one albums of all time. This is the album that fell in the number 10 spot. It's Carole King's 1971 Tapestry. It was Billboard's number one album for 15 consecutive weeks. It went platinum 13 times. Pretty amazing accomplishment.
Yeah, it's really amazing. I mean, I just happened to have watched the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction from this year, and she was finally put in, and it's amazing right. She hasn't been in. And you listen to everyone talk about her, like the professionals.
Right. Isn't it amazing how, like, everything is kind of just happens at the right time? We started doing this. This is the first album on the top 10, and she literally got inducted, like, 3 days ago.
Yeah. So...
That Taylor Swift performance of...
It was unbelievable. It was really, really incredible. And it was cool to see her pay homage to her idol, and then when her idol gets up there, gives Taylor Swift the respect of saying, she said something like, you're my professional granddaughter, which is, pretty cool.
Yeah, that had to be nice.
Yeah.
So it was nominated for a bunch of Grammys. It won Album of the Year. It won Record of the Year for It's Too Late. It won Song of the Year for You've Got a Friend. And it won Best Pop Vocal Performance by a Female for Tapestry. So, I mean...
It's pretty impressive.
Yeah. It's pretty fantastic.
Well, really impressive is that she released You've Got a Friend to James Taylor first. Even though the same year it came out. But she's like, no, here, you do it. And he went to number one with that song.
Right.
But she didn't.
Same as You Make Me Feel. She gave that to Aretha Franklin first. So she performed that first.
Well, that was with intent to be written for Aretha Franklin.
Right.
The studio went to her and said, we want you to write a song for Aretha that's about being a woman. And a few hours later, she comes back.
See, we were talking about this in our introduction episode. Just the talent. If you got it, you got it.
Yeah.
Couple minutes and she wrote one of the greatest songs ever. It was recorded at A&M Record Studios in January of 1971. What else? Carole King wrote or co-wrote all of the songs on the album. And as we were just saying, James Taylor was the one that actually encouraged her to create this album and to sing all her own songs, because originally Carole King was just writing songs for other artists.
Yeah, since a teenager, she was in the studio. Just that's what she did. She wrote so many other... if you take Tapestry out of her collection, the other songs that she wrote for other people makes her one of the greatest songwriters of all time.
Another song that she wrote for the Shirelles on this album was Will You Love Me Tomorrow. She wrote that in 1960 for the Shirelles. And 11 years later, she comes out with this. It was awesome. It was definitely different for me to listen to the entire album all the way through.
Yeah.
I had heard almost every song, but completely out of context. And this was just a much different way of enjoying this music. And I didn't think I enjoyed it as much as I did this time.
Well, the great thing about it is I have notes on every song. Everyone says it's relatable. She writes lyrics that everybody at some point has felt or wants to feel or, is striving. It's just really simple, just life and love experiences, We all feel that way at some point, and she puts it down on paper really well.
None of the lyrics are overly complicated.
No.
It's pretty straightforward stuff.
So do you want to go through the songs?
Let's start with...
Earth Move.
The way albums used to work when they were on vinyl, kids, is you had a side A and a side B. So, side A, track number one, I Feel the Earth Move. This was an unbelievable song to listen to and to just get into it. We've all heard I Feel the Earth Move. We've all heard it.
Yeah.
You can't get to this point in life without hearing that song.
And if you haven't, you're probably not looking on YouTube for a channel right. like this to watch.
That's very true. But to just like sit there and consciously just put the album on and to have this come on first, you're just, wow.
Well, that's my first note I put is instant connection with the piano. The piano right. comes in and it's just like, yeah.
It's unbelievable. That's the exact same thing that I have down as my first note. This is probably going to happen a lot.
Probably. You know, we're both so intelligent and we think the same way, so it's really probably going to happen.
Just two brilliant guys sharing the like same opinions on everything. I love the hammering of the piano. Like,
yeah, it's really groovy. Like, you know,
just like pounding on the keys to get the song on. I guess the most famous person that plays the piano that way would be Billy Joel.
Sure.
You would say. But this was unbelievable, and it was Carole King playing the piano on this song. I love the song. Listen to it. I can listen to it again and again and
yeah,
again.
Yeah, absolutely.
And again.
It
was really good. And then track two, So Far Away. I love this song, the way the acoustic guitar like accompanied and just like transitioned into the piano so nicely. It was the first time I really, really gave this song a good listen to. Again, pretty much every track on this album is the first time I've ever sat down and listened to.
Right. You know, for me, it's I put it. It's it's the type of song I would want to write. As a musician, like that's what that love song, just piano and guitar. You know, like that's the type of stuff that I love. And if I could write music, that's what I would do.
Yeah, just acoustic and piano. And
yep.
Simple, but yet it was very complex to like actually listen to. You see the little complexities that she puts in there, the arrangements. It was very, very cool.
Now I wonder, I'm thinking out loud right now, if we should add in like 15, 20 seconds of each song.
I was looking into if we could even do that.
No, you're
or
allowed
not.
To.
You can, as long as you're giving a review of,
yeah,
of a song.
Yeah, you give a review, you can't really play the whole thing, you know, but if you just a sample so we can have the song with us, so you know, people may know the song but not hearing it, and like I don't really know what you're talking about.
It's classic subject matter too. It's just distance and not being with the person you love, and it just a classic theme. It happens to everybody.
I mean, I met a girl years ago when she was in college, and she's from Eastern Europe, and she's been back there for 10 years, and I've only seen her once. I went to visit her, but we've been in contact.
Right.
So that's the song. It's like as soon as I hear it, that's my mind goes.
That's
right.
Yeah.
We're just so far away.
Right. It's one of those songs that you hear it and you instantly think of whatever. Like for you, it's that. You know, everyone thinks of something when they hear that song.
Sure. Or someone.
Right.
It's too late.
Well, first, I wanted to say something about So Far Away.
Okay.
I didn't care for that weird flute thing at the end.
Okay.
It felt like the whole song built, and it was classic beginning, middle, end. She was done singing. It was over. The piano did its little outro.
And then some guy just walked in and started playing?
Yeah, and then for 40 seconds, we have Ron Burgundy playing jazz flute at the end of the... It was just weird to me, and I had never... Again, sitting down, listening to the song for the first time, like...
To the entirety.
I was like, oh, that's over. And then and then the flute comes in. It was just odd to me. A weird way to end the song. But
I gotcha. That's just a personal thing, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I would say it's too late.
Right.
My first note is it's the reason I'm single. You know, it's so relatable to being in an unhappy relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yep.
We've all definitely been there. You know, being with someone we don't want to be with anymore.
Right. And you're waiting for them to change and become the person that you want them to be. And
yep.
Then if they finally do, it's too late.
Yeah.
You're done and it's over. But you just, I like the funk feel of this song.
Yeah.
It was interesting to listen to. I love the bass line that goes throughout the song. It's really good.
Yeah, I think you get that a lot even with simple songs in that time period. Mm-hmm. It is the, you know, the beginning of, you know, the disco era.
Right.
So you get a lot of that, mm-hmm. Those impressions.
Right. It was interesting to listen to that one. Home Again. This is the first song in the album I hadn't heard previously.
Yeah.
I've never heard this song until I listened to it this time.
Well, I know I've heard all these songs because my mother and my sister love Carole King. Mm-hmm. And I know my mom, when I told her we were doing it, she's like, you've been listening to that song since you were in the womb. You know, so she's like, you, or this album,
right?
You know, she's like, you've heard all these songs before. Yeah. You know, so I definitely, I heard it, I knew it, but to me, it was kind of, I put it, you know, it's just a kind of like a filler for the album.
See, I feel differently.
Yeah.
This is one of my favorite songs that was on the album. I thought it was just really, really good. I loved the arrangement. So again, being in a familiar place makes everything better. She can't wait to be home again.
Yeah.
I that resonates with me a lot because of what I'm currently doing for a living. I'm sure it's the same with you. Yeah. We're away from home an awful lot, and you just kind of want to, you can't wait to be done with what you're doing and be back where you want to be.
I guess for me, it was one of those, like, melodically, it wasn't pleasing mm-hmm. to me. And that's, so I guess I maybe tuned it out and the rest didn't really
right.
to me for that reason.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, and this is what we were talking about in the beginning episode too. If the music doesn't catch you,
yeah,
you know, it's very important.
Unless the lyrics are just completely amazing,
right?
You know, it could be a cappella and mm-hmm. you know, it's great words. Beautiful.
Yeah.
The title of her play. The play in Broadway, which I am definitely going to see this year. My mom has seen it a couple times.
Oh, really?
I really want to go see it. So,
not a big Broadway guy.
Really, it's so much fun. So much fun. We live in New York, man. How can you not go to Broadway?
I saw Rent.
Yeah.
And it was in the theater that it was in, and the really tiny seats, and you know, it's just.
Let's not drift too far into that.
This was probably my least favorite song on the album.
Really?
Yeah.
That's funny.
I feel like it was kind of just, you know, we've been there and done
but
that kind of.
But we haven't been there. Like, this is the beginning of girl power. This is the beginning of equality of women in music. And, you know, she was, you know, that's what this is all about. And confidence. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, yes, it's been going on for years. But she's the one of the first one to say it and do it.
I guess it was, that's all about the time I came into it.
Yeah.
Because this is another song I had never heard before. So, I mean, when it came on, that was, it was kind of like what you said about Home Again. It was kind of like filler to me.
Okay. I mean, I think it's important. You know, it's still important for everyone to feel, you know, confident.
Right.
No matter what, you know, you're beautiful no matter mm-hmm. what. So,
right.
Things like that are always important to me.
And Christina Aguilera. Later on, we'll completely
rip
this song off almost identical.
She didn't write it.
Right.
No. You know, but that's a whole, I can go into a whole thing about that. It's a whole great story with that, but we'll get there eventually.
Way Over Yonder.
Way Over Yonder.
The last song on side A of the vinyl album.
Right. What I enjoyed it was the backing vocals and the harmony in that.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed, like, it was, you know, I thought that was really good.
Was that James Taylor?
Probably that James Taylor and Joni Mitchell. It's amazing that those are people that are your background singers and songs. You know, hanging out with Carly Simon and Joni Mitchell. And
you know, you're doing something right when James Taylor's like,
yeah. That's one thing they talked about, though. They all pushed each other, were all there for each other at the same time, which is really cool.
Song had kind of a gospel-y feel to me.
It
was. Which is, again, it's never been my overly favorite genre of music, but I really enjoyed this, listening to the song, and like this one I gave a listen to twice.
Okay.
Back to back. I listened to it again as soon as it ended, because at first I didn't really care for it. I was like, I think it was just coming off of the last song not being my favorite, and then another one comes on.
It's two in a row.
And I never really cared for gospel, but the second time I listened to it, I gave it a more... You know,
open-minded.
I came into it. I said, "All right, we're going to start again, like kind of reset, and let's just listen to the song. And it, again, like you were saying, the background vocals were just incredible. Yeah. And
see, I guess really the gospel part to me was like even having that, the saxophone in there. I love saxophone music. Yep. It's just not used enough, you know. Saxophone is such so cool.
See, and, yeah, and I wrote it down again with a weird instrument in the song. It just, the saxophone just pops out of nowhere and it's just in the song. But it worked better for this song than it did for me on.
It's funny you say you don't like gospel. I remember we were talking about like a prayer from Madonna. Like that song is so much gospel.
It's so gospel. Well, that song I like to sing because it's not what you'd expect from.
It's not what you expect from Madonna.
From me, or from pretty much anyone, really, I guess. So that's what I liked about that song.
Okay.
Here it is.
Here it is.
The first song on side B, You've Got a Friend.
Probably the most recognizable song of her career.
It's one of the top songs of all time.
Yeah.
Probably. And most people, I feel, are way more familiar with the James Taylor version.
Yeah, I mean, it's... You can't have Toy Story, you know, without this song. It probably really brought the song back again in the 90s.
Right.
You know, it made a whole other group of people, young kids, that didn't know the song.
Right.
And do I look ridiculous?
A little bit. I mean, you can see yourself. If you want Dave to wear a silly hat in every episode, just comment.
Oh, boy. I guess I'm wearing silly hats for now on. There's no way that's not going to happen. Let's see.
Where You Lead. This was a really good song. Just I enjoyed it. Again, from beginning to end, we kind of sound like fanboys. We don't have really any criticisms of any of this. And I think maybe that's going to be something we experience a lot when we're going through the top 10 albums of all time.
I think we will have some bad things to say about some people.
Yeah, maybe next week.
It's funny though, what you just said, because I compared this to like one of my favorite bands. Well, probably my favorite band. Uh-huh. And this song is a continuation of other songs, like an epic, like Guns N' Roses with, you know, November Rain, Don't Cry, and Estrange. How they're really all one song. Mm-hmm. You know, they all connect. This song is kind of a continuation of other songs in the album.
Right.
It just kind of flows all together.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, now that you mention that, yeah, that's very true.
It's like a big, epic, long story.
She's telling a story with the album. Mm-hmm. And you don't get that anymore in music either.
You're
albums
like,
don't really...
You're lucky if you get a story in one song.
Right. And not just a bunch of silly sounds.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can definitely see... You can see it starting... Well, not starting, but she's... continuing it on heavily here now, like telling the story of the album.
Yeah.
And it, well, we'll get to where it wraps up, obviously.
Smackwater Jack.
Well, we missed Will You Love Me Tomorrow.
Oh, yeah, sorry, I skipped that. Yeah, my fault.
No matter how many times I hear the song, it blows me away.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just...
This is the one I know for sure, 100%, that Joni Mitchell and James Taylor are on the back.
Yeah, they're definitely the background. 100%. You can even hear them both distinctly.
Yeah.
And like how being hurt in the past kind of will make you think about any other future, you know, future relationships.
Yeah.
And you expect the same out of people. And
yeah, you hold those scars.
Yep.
Yeah, you know, and you put up walls. Again, probably another reason I'm single.
A little bit of self sabotage, maybe.
Oh yeah.
you're just waiting for that other shoe to drop all the time. So I love that song.
Yeah. And it's been covered and done so many times, you know, because it's that type of song people want to sing.
Mm-hmm. Now it's Smackwater Jack.
I mean, it's the most different, you know, cool song on the album. Very bluesy. Like, it's not...
Very bluesy.
You know, it's definitely got great bass line the whole time. It's really, really catchy. You know, you can like, dance to it, you know.
Right. The subject matter, too, makes you think, like, these polarizing kind of subjects, they've been around for longer than you know...
We've been alive.
Just, like, what we've been going through recently. So if you think, like, things like... that are going on, all mass shootings and
social problems.
All the social problems. They've been around for forever. And this is another one of you know, someone got a gun and went to a church. And
it's I hate it and I love it when I hear songs that are culturally relevant at the time, but still are culturally relevant.
Right,
you know, it's really sad.
This is absolutely still definitely one of them. Like you could listen to this song and you'd think it was written this year.
I had to listen to this song twice because with the bass line and the rhythm, I kept singing in my head, "Bad, bad Leroy Brown."
Right, and you almost exactly. Smack Water Jack, Bad Leroy.
It's really a very similar rhythm, and I just kept singing that song. I'm like, I got to listen to it again.
No, I tuned out and I started singing a different song.
Yep.
So. Tapestry. I feel like this should have ended the album.
Yeah.
This song wraps it up.
Yeah.
It wraps up the story of the album that you were trying to tell.
I'm pretty sure when they do it on Broadway that this is the final song.
Right,
we do.
Right.
It's such a Broadway musical song. Mm-hmm. It's meant to be a musical. Like, really,
I felt that the second I listened to it too. Yeah. It was very, very Broadway-ish, very explaining what she's done and where she's been and how she's ready. And at the end, if you haven't listened to it yet, at the end, how she's ready to go and have death come and take it. I felt like that would be the clear end of the album.
Okay.
But then you get the last.
You get the last song, which is, you know, most people know from Another Person.
Right.
You know, Aretha Franklin, she wrote, you know, they wrote it for her. You know, she was the star at the time.
We're talking about You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman.
We had to say that? No. You know, I can compare the two of them. To me, it's do you want the power of Aretha, you know, and her vocals,
right,
or the feeling that you get when Carole sings it. Like,
right,
she emotes the feeling.
It's definitely
more
emotional, this version.
Right, and Aretha is more just in your face.
Right,
you know.
Yep.
I'm a woman, hear me roar, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
So
it's two different takes on the exact same lyrics.
Yeah.
It's amazing what your vocal range can do to the lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
And the effect that they can have on how people interpret the song.
I'd rather listen to somebody and see their face and feel what they're feeling.
Right.
From just seeing the song on a piano.
Mm-hmm.
That's just my personal, you know, I enjoy that.
Right, yeah.
You know, I love great vocals, you know, obviously amazing to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but if you can do both, hey.
I mean, all the better. Then.
There's a new girl, Olivia Rodrigo. I don't know if you listen to any of her stuff.
Yeah,
she does that. She's got great lyrics and she can sing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so.
So yeah, when you have all the tools you need to make something like this album, it's an impressive thing to hear and listen to and appreciate. So we're basically doing what I set out to do when we started this and get a different appreciation for something we necessarily wouldn't be listening to.
Yeah.
Not that I haven't heard these songs, because the vast
been
majority.
Under a hole if you haven't heard these songs.
The vast majority of these songs I have heard many, many times.
That's what I, last week when we were talking, you're like, I've never heard this. I'm like, yes, you have. Like, you'll see.
Right. So, I feel foolish for saying that I had never heard this now.
That's the idea, you know.
But and again, I appreciate Carole King way more, like, than I would have otherwise.
Yeah.
Had I not done this, what we're doing, I wouldn't have
had the respect
or put her in anywhere even close to in the realm of what I was
saying. She's up there with McCartney and Lennon.
Amazing.
She's that good of a songwriter. There's not many people that are better songwriters than her.
No.
Even if she didn't release the stuff by herself, you know, Tapestry, the songs she did, you know, by herself.
It's similar to stuff like Chris Stapleton and Adele and all those other artists that are now doing their own music that had written for years and years prior for other people.
Yeah.
I feel like that's happening more and more, but maybe I just wasn't aware of it before, and this is stuff like...
Well, like Linda Perry from Four Non Blondes, you know, she came out with that, you know, What's Up first.
Right.
And then she became behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. Like, she found Pink, you know, she's the one who discovered Pink and writes all her stuff. We're talking about Beautiful from Christina Aguilera. Mm-hmm. She wrote that song.
Right.
You know, she didn't write it for Christina Aguilera.
Yeah. Right, but
she happened to Christina happened to walk in and hear her playing it, and she was like, "That's a great song."
Mm-hmm.
And Linda Perry was like, "Yeah, it's not for you. You wouldn't understand it." But you know, so, love the singer songwriters. Basically,
right,
what I'm saying.
Right. It's
what it comes down to.
It was it was very fun to listen to, and I really enjoyed listening to the album all the way through. Some little weird stuff.
Yeah.
Did you notice, and I couldn't, by the time I got to like the third or fourth song on the album, I couldn't unhear it. I don't know if she had a cold when they recorded the album or anything, but she's got almost like a congested kind of
sound she sings.
that her vocals make. It's a nasally sound, and it was in every single, almost like a clicking kind of like congested-y, phlegmy sound in the back of her throat.
Yeah, she sings what they call your head voice.
Right.
So she doesn't use her chest. It's the head voice. So she definitely does get more nasally sound from it.
And the difference like that I noticed with this is this album was 1971, and that stuff is going to be in the album. You're going to hear you're going to hear
every time I move my foot
in the background of a song from 1971. If this album was made today, you wouldn't hear any of that stuff.
Yeah.
They would have taken that all out.
Sure.
And just cleaned it up. I thought that was incredible to be able to like hear that stuff and say, "Oh, that's interesting."
Mm-hmm.
And it was just something I noticed that was very fun for me to hear and then to go into. So yeah.
So what's the number nine?
What we're going to be doing next week is...
The number nine album.
You guys can all look these albums up. It is Nickelback. Nickelback. All the Right Reasons from 2005.
I can't believe that was 15 years ago, 17 years ago?
Yeah, it's...
Did I do that math right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
So this album that we're listening to now was made before
we were being punished for that long.
I know there are
a few songs in there that I think are good, but a lot of it can make me want to bang my head against the wall.
Right. But we're gonna listen to it anyway.
Of course,
we're gonna go through it, and
you know what? Hopefully we're making all these comments right now. And hopefully we'll listen to it and we'll come out with a whole different perspective because we're going to listen to it with open ears.
Right, exactly. And that's the whole point. So if everybody out there is wanting to listen along with us, the next album, the number nine album on Billboard's top 10 albums of all time, it is based on how many weeks they're in the number one spot for.
Right.
So this album was in the number one spot for more weeks than Carole King's Tapestry. They must be doing something right.
Well, or it also goes to show how popular music has changed and how the different requirements to what is popular has changed.
Right. So you would definitely classify Tapestry as pop of its day.
Not pop music, but just popular, like as far as people, it could be a heavy metal song,
right.
But people are buying it.
Right.
Yeah, right. Not pop music, but what's purchased.
What would you... You'd call this rock?
She's a singer-songwriter. Mm-hmm. That's really the genre. That's a genre. Just singer-songwriter. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what it comes down to.
See, and it's remarkable how many different types of music are in this top 10 list too.
Yeah, I actually have not looked at it because I want to be surprised each week. I don't want to jump ahead. I don't want to hear a song on the radio. Oh, I'm gonna be listening to that soon. So I haven't even looked at the list yet. So.
We got a lot of good ones, and they all will be talking about. A little bit later, somebody who factors into what we were talking about earlier in this episode, Taylor Swift, we'll be listening to her a little bit later on because her and Carole King are very close to one another. That we have now that I know that after watching the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame stuff.
Yeah.
if you get a chance, listen to Taylor Swift's version of, which was it? Was it Will You Love Me Tomorrow?
Yeah, Will You Love Me Tomorrow,
She does an amazing version of Will You Love Me Tomorrow at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame that just happened last Friday.
My mother, who was very judgmental about something like that, about some music she loved, she was like, you know what? I understand it's popular music now, so that's, you know. Mm-hmm. She's like, it's really good. She's like, you know, it's she changed it to me more contemporary.
Right.
You know.
And it was just a flawless performance.
Yeah.
I mean.
Even her speech that she gave, I don't know if you watched that part.
No, I had only seen the performance.
She inducted, you know, Carol, and she gave a wonderful speech. She was really... She's really good.
And it all comes full circle. Like, I would have never listened to this album, you know, given the opportunity when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. I'm certain my mother had this album in the house. And I'm certain on Saturday mornings when we were all off and she would be vacuuming the house, she would blast albums. It was typically Melody, who is not one of the top 10 albums of all times. I Got a Brand New Pair of Roller Skates and You Got a Brand New Key, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Or it was, she played a lot of Elton John, a lot of the Beach Boys, and Neil Diamond. A lot of Neil Diamond, waking up at 9 o'clock in the morning on Saturday mornings while she's house cleaning.
Yeah, I did have the morning stuff. We weren't allowed to be awake in the morning. That was her time to sleep.
Uh-huh.
But when in the car, you know, I was lucky enough that I got Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd and Black Sabbath.
See, yeah, there it's all about taste. I'm certain that I had Carole King's Tapestry blasting at 9 in the morning on a Saturday at least once in my life.
Okay.
I was just too silly to acknowledge it because I liked heavy metal.
Too cool for school.
Right. So, continuing on, next week is going to be Nickelback.
I'm looking forward to it. I really am. I'm super excited.
We're going to get Dave on the road next week, too, probably.
Yeah, we'll be traveling. I'm going to be all throughout the country, so.
The podcast is going to have a little bit of a different look.
Yeah.
Obviously, we're tweaking things as we go here. Hopefully, our audio is a little louder this episode. We've kind of tinkered with the look of the studio here. Also, the big news for this week is you can follow us on all social media. You can send us messages and contact us on Instagram.
Please comment and give us your feedback, because it only makes us better.
Right.
You know.
For now, we're strictly on YouTube, but hopefully we're going to be on all the traditional audio only podcast stations pretty soon. If you want to contact us on Instagram and follow us, it's at Morewood_Chronicles. On Facebook, you search for the Morewood Chronicles. On Twitter, it's at Morewood Podcast. And you could always email us, morewoodchronicles@gmail.com.
And that's all right over there.
You got it. It's the right direction.
Going the right direction.
Also, if you're watching on YouTube, that big prominent logo on the corner there that says, Let's Sing. This all started by us creating a singing group on Facebook. While we were all under quarantine for COVID-19, I made a singing group. If you want, go take a look at that. You can join,
or do you have to be invited?
You can join. It will pop up if you search for it.
Okay.
But I have we have to approve. It's a private group. We didn't want people, you know, being able to. We didn't want the negativity
overtaken. Yeah.
Yeah. Groups like this could be really, it could be pretty rough if you make them public and it's a lot of trolls
toxic.
On there.
Yeah.
We don't like any of that. Everything's got to stay positive. So if you want to look for Let's Sing, you can go ahead, check that out and join. And I will approve you usually within a couple of minutes of you requesting, because I like to keep the group fresh.
Nice. All right, so I think we're going to wrap it up.
Yep, let's.
And we'll see you next time. Thank you for joining us. Hope you enjoyed it. And
you're Greg, I'm Dave, or no?
No, I'm Dave this time.
Okay.
Yes, I am Dave.
Better
That's
Mike.
Greg. All right, bye, guys.
See ya.